Good morning. Can I welcome you to the service if you're here in person, especially if you're a visitor with us? I trust you feel very much at home, and a welcome to you if you're watching online. It's good to come together to worship our God. Just by way of announcements, a few things to highlight. Please do read through your order of service, your announcement sheets, and you will find there a number of things. We've got our services coming up over the next few weeks. Next Sunday, I'll be leading the service here at 11 o'clock. And then 7 o'clock in Ballyhenry, we have our joint presbytery service. You're invited to that. And then Sunday the 10th, Andrew Dixon from Council for Congregational Life and Witness will be coming to share a wee bit of what our money for United Appeal goes to whenever it comes to the that Council for Congregational Life and Witness. And then on the 15th, you're invited also to the ordination installation of Matthew Horner in Eglinton. And then our Easter service, Reverend George Moore will be leading our service on Easter Sunday morning. You see the coffee and chat. Kirk Session, reminded of Kirk Session meeting in 309 on Tuesday night, 6:30. We're going to be spending time together working through various issues. So that's Tuesday, 27th of February at 6:30. Then also just to remind you of discipleship groups, and study 5 is available in the vestibule for picking up. It's on Psalm 126. If you want to take one of those, if you want to join in the group, still not too late, you can do it. But if you want to just take even the study and do it on your own, that's fine. Please feel free to do that. Then the Women's World Day of Prayer for Friday the 1st of March in St. Peter's and St. James's in Antrim Road. Again, Margaret will be able to give you further information on that if you need any. Margaret Sterrett. Also, North Belfast Food Bank, you can see the items that are needed in February. And then also a couple of other things which are not on the sheet. Thank you to everybody who went to the BB Curry night on Friday night and who contributed towards the Children's Cancer Unit at the Royal Victoria Hospital. Over £700 was raised through the evening. So thank you again for those who went and those who contributed to that evening. And then also the Mark's Prayer Diary is available for collection along with the Presbyterian Herald magazines out in the vestibule. Please do take those with you. Again, do please stay for tea and coffee after this morning's service. Opportunity to chat and to get to know others. So, today we're going to be thinking about Psalm 128. Confession, I found it pretty difficult to get to grips with it. So, because it looks at how God blesses us. But we'll come across some of that whenever we come to the psalm. But just as we start, I kind of thought about how God does bless us. And I want to start with those words in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3. And this is what it says. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. I mean, it goes on, and you can read it whenever you go home in Ephesians chapter 1 about the many different ways in which that works out in our lives. But as a cover-all, Paul is telling us, God has blessed us through Christ and what he has done in his life, death, and resurrection with everything that we need to please him and to follow him in his ways. There's the encouragement for us this morning. So as we come together for worship, we can do so because we have been provided with everything we need for that by his Spirit as we come together for worship. So we're going to sing together. First hymn, Glory be to God the Father, glory be to God the Son, glory be to God the Spirit, great Jehovah Three. And let's stand and sing praise to God.
Thank you.
We're going to turn to God's Word in Psalm 128. And I'm reading from the ESV translation. It says, "Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel." This is God's word for us this morning. We're going to stand together again and sing Psalm 27, "Jehovah is my light." Now we're going to join together in prayer, so let's pray. Our God, we come before you this morning realizing that every good and perfect gift comes from you. You've called us out of darkness into your wonderful light, so that we might declare your praises. You're the one who, in Christ, came into our world to win our hearts. You did this not because of anything in us, but because of your character. In Christ, we see the demonstration of your love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Through faith, you've provided the gifts of forgiveness, new life in your Spirit, and life eternal. You have indeed blessed us with every spiritual gift that we need to live lives which please you. And so we come to you in a spirit of confession as we acknowledge the sin in our lives. Forgive us that we have not resisted the devil in the way that we should have, that we have fallen prey to our own sinful desires, and that we have entertained the ways of the world. Forgive us, Lord, that our love for Jesus has at times been very weak, and we have not sought you or your will in the way that we should have. Forgive us whenever we have neglected your peace in our lives and have not pursued peacemaking as part of our responsibility in serving you. Today, our God, we also want to pray for those places in our world where there is conflict. We think of Ukraine. 2 years since the Russian attacks. Father, we pray for the people of Ukraine. Pray for the people of Russia. We ask that resolution might be found quickly. We think of the situation between Israel and Palestine. Father, for the needless loss of life, we pray that a solution might be found and that a way forward might become clear. Father, we pray too for those who have lost loved ones or have been injured in the fire in the apartment blocks in Valencia and Spain. We pray for a ministry of yours in that circumstance. Father, too, we pray for our politicians as they continue to meet in Stormont to deal with the backlog of issues created over the past 2 years. Give them wisdom as they prioritize and seek to decide where money and resources should go. We pray, too, for those in our congregation who are unwell, those in hospital, those who are sick at home, those who are dealing with ongoing health problems. We thank you, too, for the gift of marriage, the gift of family. We ask that you would strengthen those relationships to be able to reflect your love for us. We pray, too, for those in our community who are experiencing difficulties in marriage and family life, for those dealing with loneliness, marriage breakup, childlessness. Father, we ask that you would give grace where it is needed. And so we ask that you would hear all of our prayers because we pray them in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to sing again to God's praise as we sing, O God, beyond all praising.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Father, as we come to look at your word, we realize that you speak to us through that word, and so we ask you would help us to understand it, to be very clear about what you mean and what you want us to take away. Not my words, but the words of Scripture. So encourage us. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. So, what is a happy life? I wonder. Is it being successful? Achieving all the goals that I set at whatever age I'm at? Is it about being balanced, able to work, spend quality time with my family, be able to spend time with friends and enjoy my hobbies, to be able to get a balance of all of those things in my life? Is it about being popular, well thought of by everybody? Is that happy life? Or is it about being proactive, getting the house, the car, the gadgets, the fashion that I want? Or perhaps we should be asking, what's the happy life that God blesses? Is it being religious? Is the happy life that God blesses someone that goes to church, reads the Bible, prays regularly, doesn't do anybody any harm? Or is the happy life that God blesses being obedient to Him in response to what Micah tells us? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? What is the happy life? What is the life that God blesses? Well, I think Psalm 128 shows us the good life and the promised blessing that God gives. We're told the claim that God makes in our lives as His covenant people, our responsibilities, and then the blessings which come as we follow Him. Now, that's given to us in Psalm 128 in the Old Testament context, and I think that's very important. But let's look, first of all, what's the blessed life? Well, we're told, blessed is everyone who fears the Lord and walks in His ways. I want you to notice a couple of things there. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord and walks in His ways. Everyone who meets God's criteria will be blessed by Him. There are no exclusions. There are no elite Christians, those who are better or worse than anybody else. Not more blessed or less blessed than anyone else. Everyone who fulfills those responsibilities will know God's blessing. So what does it mean to be blessed by God? What is God telling us there? Well, to be blessed means, as it does in the Sermon on the Mount, blessed are those who, to be approved by God. And so the challenge for us here, as we meet that word blessed, is whose approval are we seeking this morning? Do we really want the approval of God above every other approval that we seek? Do we want God's approval, and are we prepared to gain it in the way that He asks us? Do you know, the truth of the matter is that many people spend their lives looking for approval in the wrong places. Places where that approval may never, ever come. The disapproving parent. The unpleasable boss. The narcissistic friend. Eugene Peterson suggests that blessing is an inner strength of soul and the happiness it creates, the vital power with which no human being can exist. And he then adds to that The blessing comprises the power to live in its deepest and most comprehensive sense. So this is God's gift to us, his approval, his blessing, which enables us to live in a way that nobody else can, who is not blessed by him. So is God the person that you're seeking to provide the power to live life to its full? Because that's what his approval is all about. And this is ultimately fulfilled in Jesus Christ, who gives us his Holy Spirit to transform us from within, enabling us to live the life that he intends us to live. So God's approval is about God coming into our lives and enabling us to live life in the deepest, most meaningful way that it's possible. He's the one who enables us to accomplish that, to live life as it's intended. But what the psalmist is telling us is that God's approval is on those who do two things. The first one, well, it's fear the Lord and walk in his ways. In short form, this is worship, fearing the Lord, leading to obedience, walking in his ways. But also worship, well, worship leading to obedience, and obedience leading to worship. To fear the Lord is about taking God seriously, allowing him to be who he is, the God of creation, the God of the cross, the God of the resurrection, the God who gives us every breath that we take, and the God to whom we are accountable, the God who has revealed himself from Genesis to Revelation, that we take him seriously, believing that he is who he said he is and how he relates in our lives. Fearing God means having a sense of awe and reverence at him, living a life which is conscious of his presence and his being, his existence. Fearing God means living life with a sense of his presence, of worship, of listening to him, and not limiting him to the concept that we have of God. Fearing the Lord. That's what we're called to do. To have that sense of him and who he is, taking him seriously, not assuming that we know him, not working from a concept that we have in our own heads about how he deals with people and what he's like and what he says, but taking God seriously as he's revealed himself in his word. But then also walking in his ways. Well, that means that we do the things for which he has made us. We follow his ways and his commands. We do what he says, as scripture always challenges us. Don't just be hearers of the word, but doers. And so our priorities come from our interactions with him by his Spirit through his word. So our lives then become an obedience to him. We walk in the ways that we see him walking in as we think about Christ. And so we respond to his call to love him with everything that we have in heart and mind and soul. We apply his morality to our lives. We seek social justice and fairness, thinking about human dignity and human rights, that we build good relationships with all, being peacemakers in the fullest sense of that word. Google Maps is a great idea, absolutely brilliant, especially in ministry. If you get an address or you go into a meeting and you're not sure exactly where it is, you stick on Google Maps and it directs you to the place, to the front door, to the meeting or the house or wherever it is you're going to. There is a problem though. There are problems arise whenever I think I know the way, or I think I know a quicker way than Google. And sometimes I do. But other times, I get lost. I get frustrated and even get angry. And then I have to stop. I have to stop the car and start Google up to switch Google Maps back on again to get me onto the right path. But isn't that so true with walking in the ways of God? Sometimes we think we know the way. We think we know what pleases God. We think that we've got it sorted. And then eventually we have to get to the point of, Lord, I'm sorry. Let me get back to your word. Let me get back to the base unit so I can discover what you're saying to me. Because we walk in God's ways, we receive God's blessing. If we don't walk in God's ways, we don't receive his blessing. So, the blessing of God. Now the bit that I kind of struggled a bit with, because it tells us in Psalm 128, 2-4, about the nature of God's blessing. And it tells us of what God's blessing is and how it will come to those who fear him and walk in his ways. It says, you shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. Now, that's lovely, isn't it? Beautiful picture. God blessing the individual, God blessing the marriage, and God blessing the family. And even we're told in this situation that Jerusalem will be blessed, the city will be blessed through this, and also hope to see your children's children and your many descendants. And beautiful picture. But I think we need to be very careful in how we apply this thinking to what being successful is all about. Because the danger is that we then see success as only those who are employed, married with children, and lots of them. And that be our concept of the only way that God blesses those who fear him and walk in his ways. We need to understand the context of these verses. Israel with God's chosen land and nation. Jerusalem was his chosen city. The Israelites were his chosen people, and you were part of that people and faith through birth. So it was all very physical. And the blessings mentioned were symbols of what Hebrew society valued and were physical blessings. They also reflect the priority of the old covenant, which God made with his people to give them land and descendants as numerous as the sand at the sea. So fruitful labor on the land, a wife in marriage, many children, and a blessed city, a large number of descendants. Those were all blessings of the Old Testament. But the truth is that each of these gifts are given by God. And therefore, we are to thank him for those. It is important that we thank God for every gift that he gives to us, whether it is employment, whether it is marriage, whether it is family, whether it is descendants or blessing on the city. But I also want to note that those blessings are limited. These are not the only ways in which God blesses his people. We need to look to the whole of Scripture to bring it all together to see the gifts that God gives to us, or the way in which he blesses us as his people. The emphasis on gift of marriage partner and the number of children sitting around the table, the idea of being of the number and the potential help that they could be in the future. It is important that we place these blessings in context of the whole Bible and not narrowly see these things as the only way in which God blesses those who fear him and walk in his ways. The coming of Jesus Christ changed everything. The church, the body of Christ, is the holy nation. Believers In Christ are the people belonging to God, chosen by him to declare his good news about Jesus Christ. And the New Jerusalem will be in heaven. And so Jesus Christ is able to provide what the Old Testament looks forward to in hope and didn't experience. When God says, for example, in Jeremiah or in Ezekiel, when God will give us a new heart and put his spirit within us to enable us to walk in his ways, when the fullness of God is able to dwell in us in Christ, as the New Testament talks about. And so the blessing in Christ, the one that he brings, is abundant life. Life to the full, which talks about in John 10, and which is able to be lived in the power of his Holy Spirit. And so Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount gives us clear instruction on who is approved by God. God's approval comes as we turn to Christ and put our trust in him. And you can see a development right through the whole Sermon on the Mount. Yes, we still recognize that our work is a gift from God and that we are able to glorify him in it. And to do so as if it's him that we're serving in our work. But sometimes God blesses us even whenever we're not employed. We're able to receive his gifts, his enabling, his grace, whenever we're not employed for reasons beyond our control. But yes, marriage is a gift from God. And we thank him for our spouses. And as I've often said at weddings, no one has a divine right to a happy marriage. Take, for example, Hosea. When God taught him and his people so much through the example of his experience and his wife and her leaving him and treating him very badly. And yet God blessed him through that experience. We are called to give thanks for our spouses. We're also called to love our spouses so that our marriages are to be a reflection of Christ's love for us. And it takes two people to do that. It is wrong for only one to be giving love and the other doing all the receiving. Yes, marriage is a gift, a very special gift from God. Children are a gift too. We're also told in Scripture that we are to encourage and to love our children, to walk with them, even through those difficult times. Yes, those teenage years, and sometimes even beyond it. But we're to walk with them, we're to love them in Christ. The thing about children is that God doesn't promise us the finished product whenever he gives us our children. Our calling is to work with them, to love with them. What we discover through all of this is that Christ's blessing is not limited. God blesses in many ways. But if those ways are the only ways that God blesses us, then there are many people going to be disappointed. But even whenever we feel disappointed, I was reading again, it came into my mind whenever I was preparing this, the story in Genesis 16, I don't know whether you know it or not. It's about Hagar, the maidservant of Abram, who struggled whenever Sarah wasn't having children and Sarah said, look, well, why don't you provide a child and all this? And then eventually, whenever Sarah really goes for her, doesn't appreciate her, and eventually she has to walk away from the place, and she's walking away on her own. And thinking, gosh, that's horrible. But then God comes alongside her. She's getting out of a difficult situation where she has felt used and abandoned. And God comes alongside her and asks, where have you come from? And where are you going? incredible. That's how God comes alongside us. Whenever we feel that disappointment, maybe we don't have the blessing, some of the blessings that are mentioned in this passage. And then we read, the Lord then confirms that she will bear a son who was called Ishmael. But we then read, so she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, "You are a God of seeing." For she said, "Truly here I have seen him who looks after me." If you're struggling this morning thinking God hasn't blessed you, or if you're thinking about God hasn't blessed you in the ways that are mentioned here, just remember Hagar, the Lord who sees you. Where have you come from and where are you going to? What's been your experience? Talk to me. Where are you going to? I can lead you. I can take you where I want you to go. But you know, even as I thought through this, I thought about, you know, being reminded by Paul in 1 Corinthians 7, verses 68, he talks about being single. He talks about being single as a gift from God. And he even adds that he wishes others were as he is. God's blessing can also come on those who've had a difficult or bad experience in marriage, where they now find themselves single again. Because our mistakes in God's economy, in Christ, never define us. Failure is never final whenever it comes to Jesus Christ. Maybe there's hurt. Maybe there's disappointment because of that. And yet the story of Hagar just reminds us, where have you come from and where are you going to? But also, God's blessing can come to those who are struggling with children, struggling with issues in their lives, even those who are and have been wayward. It's those times sometimes that we feel the grace of God most. Whenever God comes alongside us, as I said, God doesn't hand us the finished product. And God's blessing can also come on those who struggle or are unable to have children. Many parents who have had children with disabilities speak of the amazing gift that God has given to them. I'm not qualified to speak about any of that. I can only point out what others have shared with me and the blessing and the grace of God in those difficult times and knowing his blessing through those. What God says to us in Christ changes everything. He gives us a different perspective. And we've looked a few times in this series in the Psalms of Strength for the Journey about those words in Romans 8, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ. None of the things that I've mentioned, either that are perceived as blessing or perceived as difficulties, none of that can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. God is able to bless us and show us his approval in the midst of all of that. As we look to him, as we fear him, and as we walk in his ways. No matter who you are, what your experience, you can know the blessing and approval of God on your life in amazing ways. But we're told in verses 5 and 6, as the psalm concludes, of the blessing of Jerusalem and the community of God's people. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel. Amazing words. Again, applied to Jerusalem as the context of the God's city and God's people. But even whenever God's people went to Babylon, Do you remember what he said to them in Jeremiah 24, verses 4 to 7? He says, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon," that's every one of them, "build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease." But then this beautiful line, which applies to us today as well. "But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare." There's an encouragement. That's the heart of this psalm and these verses. For the people in Jerusalem, work for Jerusalem. Because in that city, then you will know your blessing as it's blessed. And that's true for us. As we seek to be a blessing as the people in the body of Christ within our community, as we bless the community, so our blessing will come. God's call is that whatever physical community we work in, we are to seek its blessing. And as it's blessed, so we too will be blessed. And that applies as much to Belfast or North Belfast as it does to Babylon. Having said that, though, we realize that the prosperity of Jerusalem is the new covenant. In the new covenant is about not necessarily blessing Jerusalem as it presently is. Because in Christ, the partial fulfillment of Jerusalem is the church, the body of Christ. It is in fearing God and walking in his ways that the church is blessed. Just in the same way in the Old Testament, in fearing God and walking in his ways, the city of Jerusalem is blessed. The temptation is for us to do God's work our way and expect him to bless it. But I also think we need to be very careful here too in applying this to the local church. Because the reality is that sometimes local churches close, and there may be various reasons for that. But our calling as the local church is to be faithful to what God has revealed to us. As the church worldwide, as the church invisible, we are called to fear him and walk in his ways. As the church visible, we are also called to fear him and to walk in his ways, and to proclaim his message and live lives in the power of his Holy Spirit, glorifying him, that we continue to work out our salvation. And as the church is blessed, so the community will be blessed. And as the community is blessed, so we will be blessed. Again, the children's children, in the context of the New Testament, could relate to people coming to faith. Future generations turning to Christ because of the faithfulness of the people of God, fearing him and walking in his ways. The final word is that the people of God would experience peace. That wholesome relationship with God, with his people in our environment. That peace which passes all understanding and is able to guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus to enable us to keep going. The happy life. Or the life approved by God. Or the life that God blesses is one in which we fear him and walk in his ways. Walking in his ways in Christ, in the power of his Holy Spirit. Then we will know his blessing on our circumstances, whatever those circumstances be. Whether they be difficult, whether we deem them to be testing, whether we deem them to be brilliant, great, whatever way we see them, we will know God's blessing in our lives. Let's pray together. Father, we turn to you today and we thank you for your word and for the totality of that word, that we can see Psalm 128 in the context of all that you've said, to realize that the blessed life, the life with your approval seal on it, is a life which fears you and walks in your ways in Christ, seeking to honor him in all that we do. Father, we know we are weak. Often we fail. And yet we ask for your grace and your strength as we go out from this service, that we might be able to do that in the power of your Holy Spirit, as you speak to us through your word, as we seek your approval above all other approvals in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing together. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Let's stand together to praise God. Thank you for coming this morning to our worship. Thank you for joining with us online. Thank you to everyone who has played a part in making the service possible this morning. I am conscious of the fact that I said I found the Psalm 128 very difficult, and that we're dealing with a lot of very difficult issues. If there's anything that has been raised in that for you, please feel free to come and speak to me about that, and we can chat through it and pray through it and seek God. I want to finish up just with the benediction that is in 2 Corinthians 13 and verse 14. It says, "The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen."